2,000 years ago. YaHuWaH spoke to his servant Abraham, saying, "Because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very heavy, I am going down now to see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry against it that has come to me, and if not, I know." YaHuWaH sent two messengers to spy out the city, and after experiencing the violence and corruption of Sodom firsthand, the fate of the city was sealed. Genesis chapter 19, verse 24. And YaHuWaH rained sulfur and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from YaHuWaH out of the heavens. So he overthrew those cities, and all the plain, and all the inhabitants of the cities, and all that grew on the ground. And early in the morning, when Abraham arose, and he went to the place where he had stood before YaHuWaH, and he looked toward Sodom and Gomorrah, and toward all the land of the plain, and he looked and saw the smoke of the land, which went up like the smoke of a furnace. Nearly 4,000 years ago, the creator of the universe, YaHuWaH, destroyed the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah, Adma and Zeboim, those wicked, perverse cities that lived along the ancient border of the land of Canaan or Canaan. Those who lived along the Jordan Valley and the Dead Sea, which has also been called the Salt Sea in the Torah. The Torah, the word of YaHuWaH, gives the exact location of these wicked cities. YaHuWaH rained down fire and brimstone upon these cities for the abominations, the filthy practices which were being done within them. YaHuWaH looked and saw that the land was covered in violence, covered in hatred, covered in idleness, covered in sexual immorality, and in the worship of idols. YaHuWaH will not be mocked. What a man sows, he shall reap. Thus saith the word of YaHuWaH. This message is a testimony. It is a witness against the abominations that are being done in this generation, at this time, all over the world. YaHuWaH left us a great witness in the earth, because along the ancient border of the Canaanites, you can still see to this very day, these ancient ruins where YaHuWaH has turned these cities into nothing more than ash and sulfur in his great wrath. The book of Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 23 says, "All the land is sulfur and burning. It is not sown, nor does it bear, nor does any grass grow there, like the overthrow of Sodom and Amorah, Adma and Zeboim, which YaHuWaH overthrew." In his displeasure is what the scripture says. In his displeasure and his wrath, YaHuWaH overthrew these wicked cities. And in the culture and the times that we live, we see that the sins of these cities are very much the same today as they were back then. Josephus, the great historian of the first century, who was also a Kohen, a priest, tells us explicitly, the traces of the five cities are still to be seen. If the traces of the cities were still to be seen in the time of Josephus the historian, we should understand, brothers and sisters, and those of you all over the land who will hear my words, we need to understand that if this is the case, there has been nothing that has taken place geographically to this land since the time of Josephus nearly 2,000 years ago. Therefore, if it was a witness in his time, if it could be seen in his time, it can be seen today. And brothers and sisters, and all of you all over the world who hear my voice, you are seeing the ruins of those ancient cities. The book of Bereshith, Genesis chapter 10, verse 19, tells us, "And the border of the Canaanites was from Sidon, and you go toward Gerar, as far as Azah, and you go toward Sodom, and Amorah, and Admah, and Zeboam, as far as Lasha." This tells us explicitly where these cities were, and the ruins which we see line up directly with these landmarks, with these cities, with the territories that are outlined in YaHuWaH's word, because YaHuWaH's word remains true throughout the test of time. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change. In Him there is no shadow of turning. YaHuWaH Elohim remains the same today. The same Elohim who destroyed these ancient cities for the wickedness, for the perversions, for the abominations. He is the same one who remains on the throne to this day. He is the same one who will soon judge the entire earth in His great wrath. The book of Genesis chapter 14, verse 1, you could go and examine it. It tells us explicitly that these cities were along the Salt Sea. The Salt Sea is the Dead Sea. So according to the Torah, we know there is no guesswork being done. We know exactly where these ruins are. The history, the Torah, the geography, and the archaeology all points to one location and to an entire heap of ruins that is nothing more than gypsum ash and sulfur, just as the scriptures tell us that it should be. When we examine the ruins of ancient Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboam, we see clearly that these structures that are found here are unlike anything that is found in the natural world. We see 90 degree angles. We see geometric shapes. We see symmetry. These are the types of things that declare to an archaeologist that man has built something here. That is what people look for when they are looking for ruins, when they are looking for history, when they are looking for artifacts of human civilization, after all. And this is what we see, and it can be seen all the way down the coast. And you can see these markers from Masada. You can see these things. They're huge, they're enormous. And when you go and you examine them, you will find that they are nothing more than gypsum ash. They break apart just by rubbing your hands through them. They look like solid structures from a distance, but when you go to touch them, they just crumble off. When we examine the city further, we see four-cornered structures, such as this one, which is surrounded by a very deep moat. We also see in the center of the city a large sphinx-shaped object. This would have been an idol that was supposed to watch over the city. Also see pyramid shapes that point to the religion of ancient Sodom. Also see square windows in the structures that give us insight into the life of the inhabitants of the city. Arched doorways can be seen. Towers can be found in the corner of the city. There is an abundance of proof in the land. Gypsum ash is made with fiery sulfur and calcium. That is one testimony to the fact of what took place in this area. Formations are made in this area of layers. The layers are all gypsum ash, and they're unlike anything in the surrounding terrain. The layers are comprised of calcium carbonate, which is gray in color, and you can see the patterns when you look at the various structures. You can see the patterns in the formations. You'll see a gray color, then you'll see the white color. The white color is calcium sulfate, and it is due to the brimstone, which is literally, brimstone is literally sulfur balls that have caught a flame. That is what brimstone is. So quite literally, what you see here are structures of buildings, but these buildings are no longer, you know, just a solid structure. They're powder. They're powder, nothing more than gypsum, ash, and sulfur. And that's all that they are. But yet you can still see the outline of the buildings all around. It's interesting that these structures even remain after 4,000 years, after, you know, rain and wind erosion. But thankfully, this is in a desert location, so there isn't that much rain. But if this is as visible now as it is, and as obvious as it is today, how much more obvious was it 2,000 years ago when the great historian Josephus recorded that you could still see the remains? Something to think about. You can see structures contain 90-degree angles, as I mentioned earlier. These are obviously always markers that tell archaeologists that humans built monuments here. They built civilizations here in this place. The structures were completely consumed with the fire and the brimstone. But the substance that was used, that fire and brimstone, is much heavier than the actual ash, leaving the shape behind. So therefore, it basically, the fire and the brimstone kind of molded the ash into what you see today. Much like if you were building a sandcastle and you used a bucket, you dump the bucket onto the sand and it retains the shape. This is kind of what took place. The fire and the brimstone were literally like the bucket. It held the shape of the ashen remains that would be found within. So that is the reason we still see the shapes. YaHuWaH preserved them so that we would see, so that we would fear, so that we would tremble before Him and before His presence, and to understand the wrath that was going to come out upon this earth. YaHuWaH was preparing us. Thermal ionization can be seen in Sodom and Gomorrah. Thermal ionization occurs at 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit. 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And it produces the swirling designs that you see in these buildings. Volcanic rhombic sulfur, which is what is normally found on planet Earth, is only 40% pure and is in a crystalline form. But the unique brimstone that is found in Sodom and Gomorrah is 98% pure sulfur. Samples have been taken and tested in prestigious laboratories all over the world. And all of them have noted that this sulfur is unlike anything found on Earth. That is because the source of the sulfur, according to Torah, it came from the heavens. It came from Shamayim. So this would be unlike any sulfur known to mankind. This sulfur is so pure that it can melt stainless steel. That is how strong of a substance we are talking about. Something unlike what is found on the planet. This is a testimony in the earth. YaHuWaH Elohim will not be mocked. What a man sows, he shall reap. This is a witness to this perverted and wicked generation that we live in these days. the YaHuWaH Elohim shall utterly consume this earth with fire, as it has been recorded by the mouth of the prophets. Hallelujah. He shall rule and reign. And any nation, any law that tries to oppose YaHuWaH, he shall deal with in his time. YaHuWaH is long-suffering. He is patient. He is kind. But we are at the end of the age. We are at the time frame where the master is at the door. Even as it is written, Yahushua the Messiah specifically said that he is at the door. And he also said, when the Son of Man, the Ben Adam, when he comes, will he find emunah? Will he find perseverance or belief in the earth? We live in a lawless time. In the book of Luke, Lucas chapter 17, verse 26, these are the words of our Messiah, the Mashiach, the Son, the Ben of YaHuWaH, the one who came forth into the world, the one who was slain at the hands of wicked men, and the one who rose and lives forever. These are his eternal words. And as it came to be in the days of Noah, so also it shall be in the day of the son of Adam, the Ben Adam, the son of Adam. They were eating, they were drinking, they were marrying, and they were given into marriage until the day that Noah went into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. And likewise, as it came to be in the days of Lot, they were eating, they were drinking, they were buying, they were selling, they were planting, and they were building. Until the day that Lot went out from Sodom, and it rained fire and sulfur from the Shemayim, from the heavens, and destroyed them all. It shall be the same in the day that the Ben Adam, the son of Adam, is revealed. In that day, he who shall be on the housetop and his goods in the house, let him not come down to take them away. And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back. Remember the wife of Lot. Remember the wife of Lot. This is going to be key. I want you to remember the life of Lot. We are going to look at what happened in ancient Sodom and Gomorrah. Why did YaHuWaH destroy these inhabitants? What had they done to displease him? What is the history and the foundations of ancient Sodom? But to understand this, we must go back to the patriarch. We must go back to Abraham, the friend of YaHuWaH, the one that YaHuWaH made a covenant with, and with his seed, Yitzhak, who has been called Isaac, and with his seed, Yaakov, who is called Jacob, who is renamed Yisrael or Yasharel. Hallelujah. Abraham is the forefather. We go back to him and we look at his life. We will see many parallels in his life and the time of this wicked generation, this wicked time at the end of the age that we live in. Abraham's father, Terah, left the land of Ur to journey to the land of Canaan. On the way, they stopped in the land of Haran. And Haran, YaHuWaH spoke to Abraham, saying, go yourself out of the land, from your relatives and from your father's house, to a land which I show you, and I shall make you a great nation, and barak you, or bless you, and make your name great, and you shall be a berakah, and I shall barak those who barak you, and curse him who curses you, and in you all the clans of the earth shall be baruch. Abraham was 75 years old when he crossed the Euphrates River into the land that was promised to his descendants. At this time, pagan civilizations covered the land of Canaan. But it was the will of the Creator, YaHuWaH, that all of these pagan civilizations should be utterly destroyed. After inhabiting the land for some time, Abraham's nephew Lot and his family decided that they would go and migrate to Sodom, to the city of Sodom, that they could use the commerce and the economy of Sodom to make a better life for themselves. Abraham gave Lot the decision which way he should go. And Lot chose to go the direction of Sodom because he saw that it was well watered. The scripture says that the land of Sodom was so well watered that it appeared to be like the garden of YaHuWaH, like Gain Eden, like the Garden of Eden. This is how wonderful Sodom was. It looked very beautiful. Lot had herds. He needed to feed them. He needed to tend to them. Surely it made sense to go to the fertile plain, this fertile plain where Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboim all had this thriving economic, booming marketplace and all these things that were happening at the time. But what was inside of Sodom was perversion and wickedness, violence and corruption. Lot took the easy way out. He looked to man for help. And the scripture says, cursed is the man who puts his trust in man, who makes flesh his arm. YaHuWaH Elohim has told us to put our trust in him. That was Lot's first mistake. Lot decided to seek shelter in the large economic system of Sodom. Sodom and Gomorrah's culture included their religious, political, and economic perspective. And this was a byproduct of the ancient Tower of Babel. You see, Abraham, before he came out of Haran, before he even came out of Ur, he was in the provinces of ancient Babel. He was in the provinces of ancient Babylon. And sometime before this, the king Nimrod, who was a picture of the first anti-Mashiach, the anti-Messiah, he was like, you know, a man who had deified himself on the earth to receive the worship of the people. He was a great tyrant on the earth. And he had told the people, since they were all of one language, that they should build a tower. Now, keep in mind that not much time before the Tower of Babel would be built, Noah, who is called Noah, and his three sons and their wives had just got off the ark. Civilization had just been recreated, and they begin to have children, and their children's children and their children's children begin to spread out through the earth. And one of the major first projects that they set out on was to build a one world government, a one world religion, a one world economy. And they did it in the provinces of ancient Mesopotamia, in the ancient areas of Babel. And here they built this great tower. And when they built this great tower, if you read Genesis correctly, you will see that Noah, who is Noah, was still alive to see that this was the way that man was going. The man had already fallen away, and they had begun to worship man. They had begun to worship the fallen messengers. They had begun to worship demons and devils, idols made of stone, idols made of wood, of gold, and of silver. And Noah, who labored and built the ark for 100 years, he was able to see the wickedness of man. He was alive when this took place. YaHuWaH saw the corruption that was taking place in ancient Babylon, and he confounded the languages, and he divided the nations. He divided the nations. He put them according to their language, according to their tribes, and he mixed their language. That is why the tower was called Babel, after all, because the word Babel means confusion. It means mixture. It means disorder. There's all kinds of things that Babel means, but those words essentially describe what Babel is. And the reason that I'm telling you about Babel is because Babel basically gave birth to cities like Sodom and Gomorrah and Admah and Zeboim. And what we must understand about Babel is that Nimrod had declared basically that he was a mighty one in the earth to be praised, and he wanted this great tower to be built. And his wife was also worshipped as a deity on the earth. Her name at the time, according to various Babylonian texts, was Semiramis. But the scriptures call her Asherah and Ashtaroth. When you read in the scriptures about the mighty ones that were worshipped in the other lands, you will oftentimes see that they worshipped Ashtaroth. They worshipped Asherah. And they worshipped such mighty ones that today are called Ishtar and Easter and Ostara. All these names which the Torah actually tells us not to speak, but I'm speaking them to give you fair warning that she was seen as a mighty one, one to be worshipped. They made idols of her. This is what the idol of Diana of the Ephesians was, after all, that we read about in the book of Acts. A spinoff of the ancient worship of the mother deity of that ancient whore of Babylon. And this is what the book of Revelation is insinuating when it mentions the term whore of Babylon. It is going back, it's taking you back as a picture and a foreshadowing in the book of Revelation of something that was in ancient times. When Nimrod was killed and his body parts were thrown around his empire, they were chopped in little bit pieces and it was spread throughout his empire. Only his male reproductive organ could not be found, so therefore Ishtar or Easter, Ostara, Ashtaroth, whatever you may want to call her, decided that it should come to pass that they should build monuments to his male reproductive organ. Therefore, they built the obelisks. And therefore, today we have the steeples. And you see obelisks everywhere. This obelisk was also a picture and a remembrance of the Tower of Babel of ancient Babylon. Now, when YaHuWaH destroyed Babylon, and he put the peoples at odds with each other because they no longer spoke the same language. They no longer believed they were one. They were very much divided, and there was wars, and there was famines, and there was strife. And it was in this kind of an environment that Abraham came out of Ur, and then he came out of Haran. He came out after the destruction of Babel. There's a picture and a foreshadowing here. But the reason that I'm bringing these things up is because to understand Sodom and Gomorrah, we have to understand the roots of Sodom and Gomorrah is ancient Babylon. The scripture says so much about Babylon. Yahushua, the Messiah, the teacher tells us in the book of Revelation, come out of Babylon, my people, that you not partake in her sins. This is our battle cry in these last days. This is the message, the writing on the wall in these last days. So, Abraham crosses the Euphrates River at age 75. He is a descendant of Eber, therefore he is called an Ivri, or a Hebrew. But because he crossed over, he was also reaffirmed as a Hebrew, because the word Eber means, literally, to cross over. And so therefore we see in the life of Abraham a picture of coming out of Babylon and being set apart to YaHuWaH, crossing over that Euphrates River and coming into the promised land, leaving Babylon behind. And he left the traditions that were being done in Babylon far behind and embraced the one true Elohim, YaHuWaH Elohim, and YaHuWaH declared that he would make of him a great nation. But this is the time period that YaHuWaH decided he would destroy Babylon. If we look at Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 24, it says, YaHuWaH, your Elohim, is a consuming fire. That's what the Torah says. Malachi chapter 4, verse 1 reads, for look, the day shall come, burning like a furnace, and all the proud and every wrongdoer shall be stubble. And the day shall come that shall burn them up, says YaHuWaH Sabaoth, YaHuWaH of hosts, which leaves to them neither root nor branch. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 8. Therefore, wait for me, declares YaHuWaH, until the day I rise up for plunder. For my judgment is to gather the nations, to assemble rains, to pour out on them my rage and my burning wrath, for by fire and of my jealousy, all the earth, kol ha'aretz shall be destroyed. All the earth shall be consumed. YaHuWaH is going to call the leaders of the world. He's going to assemble their armies. He's going to assemble their people, and he's going to go into judgment with them. And we are on the verge of this time, even now. The kingdom of YaHuWaH, the Malkut YaHuWaH, happens in stages. There are various judgments that will take place, and this judgment will be echoed over and over a few times. YaHuWaH Elohim will destroy them when the Mashiach comes. He will destroy them with the fire and with the sword, and then there shall be a time in the future where he destroys the whole earth in the fire. So we are looking at this, and we are seeing that man today is very proud. Man today believes that he is his own Elohim. He determines what is right and wrong, because he has been told by men and women who are, you know, just puppets of this system and puppets of the lie, that their life is not valuable because they are not willed by the Creator to be here. There is no Creator in their minds, so therefore, man is nothing more than a series of mutations that have taken place. They call this nonsense evolution. And it's because of some of these teachings today that man believes there is no standard. But these people who believe in such a thing believe there is a such thing as good and evil. They believe there's a such thing as right and wrong, even though they may say they don't. They'll say it's subjective. But when you infringe on their rights, they're quick to point out that they've been done wrong, that there has been a wickedness done against them. All human beings acknowledge that there is tov, or what is great, and there is ra, there is what is evil or wicked. All human beings. I don't care what they say with their mouth. I'm saying how they judge things when they go and they deal with people and they deal with their rights versus others. You know, when they, in just a real situation, they know down deep in their hearts that there is a reality. It's called conscience. That's what we call it in English. Con means to have. To mean it means with. And shense comes from the word science or knowledge. It means they came into this world with knowledge. You come into this world with X amount of knowledge. People know before they've been pre-exposed to things like murder, they know that it's wrong. You know, there's a gut-wrenching, you know, just a built-in knowledge that YaHuWaH has put within every human being. And therefore, they have an awareness of what is wrong. YaHuWaH breathed into Adam. He breathed into man the breath of life. This is literally called the neshama, and he breathed into his nostrils this amount of reality, this amount of understanding that separates him from the animal. You know, an animal does not reason, it does not ponder, it does not write poetry, it does not make music, not the way that a human being does. It does not think and ponder about the stars and all these things. I'm not saying that animals are stupid and they're void of emotions. They have nefesh, is what the Torah says. Nefesh means they have emotion, they have feelings, but they are separate from the human being. Scripture says Adam was made in the likeness and pattern of YaHuWaH Elohim. So therefore, it is very important to know how we are to conduct ourselves on the earth, how to live on the earth. The Creator YaHuWaH has told us how that we are to live. So now let's get back to Abraham. Abraham was 75 years old when he came out of the provinces of Babel. He had been raised in Ur. Then they went to Haran. Then he crosses over at age 75 over the river Euphrates, and he brings with him his family and he brings his nephew Lot. And Abraham came out of Babel after the destruction of the Tower of Babel. We don't really know for sure the exact time frame there, but we have a pretty decent idea, according to the Torah, that after the Tower of Babel had been destroyed and the violence and all the things had begin to erupt in the region, around this time period was when Abraham went to Haran with his father, and around, you know, however long later, at age 75, is when he heard the voice of YaHuWaH to come out of Haran, and he went into the Promised Land. And when he comes into the Promised Land, he brings his nephew Lot, and he gives Lot a decision. to either go to the right or go to the left, and Abraham would do the opposite because they had many servants and they had large herds, and they would consume the land if they were just all together. So they divided up, and Lot was given the decision, so therefore he chose the beautiful oasis of Sodom that looked like the garden of YaHuWaH according to the scriptures. But he's going back spiritually, mentally. In a way, he's going back into Babylon because Sodom and Gomorrah is nothing more than a byproduct of the civilization. So therefore, the civilization that I described to you, where they worship Nimrod as the father and Ishtar as the mother, and they worship the baby deity that they call Tammuz, the sun deity. All this is recorded in the scriptures. We see all this revelation in the scriptures. This would be the type of religion, the type of economic structure, the type of politics that would take place in Sodom and Gomorrah. Same exact thing, nothing different. In Better Sheath, Genesis chapter 18, we see that YaHuWaH comes and visits with Abraham. And two malakim, or messengers, been erroneously called angels. That word comes from Anglios, it has pagan origin. Most of the time when you say the word angel, a person thinks of an effeminate male or a literal female that has a halo and wings. That's just not the case. Messengers in the scriptures, malakim, are described as men. So it's really important to have the right understanding. YaHuWaH comes with two malakim and he visits with Abraham. And it's a very powerful read if you read Bereshith, Genesis chapter 18. And eventually the two messengers, the malakim, go away and they begin to go towards Sodom. And YaHuWaH tells Abraham what is happening, that he is going to go down to Sodom and see if the outcry against Sodom is truly as he has heard, so that he can righteously judge Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham immediately begins to fear because of Lot, his nephew. His nephew is dwelling in the city of Sodom. And Abraham begins to reason with YaHuWaH if he would destroy the righteous and the wrong. And eventually Abraham comes up with the number 10. He says, if there are just 10 righteous in the city of Sodom, would you please spare the city for the 10 righteous? YaHuWaH says, for 10. I will spare the city. So in the next chapter, chapter 19, we read that Lot encounters the messengers of YaHuWaH in the city square. The messengers had determined that they were going to sleep for the night in the city square so that they could truly see what was going on in this wicked city. But Lot urged them, and he said, no, come into my home, I will you know, make you a feast. And he provides them matzah or unleavened bread, and they have a meal and all these things. It's a very powerful narrative. But I want to get to Genesis, Bereshith 19 a little further, and I'm going to begin reading in verse 4. Before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both old and young, all the people from every part surrounded the house. And they called to Lot and said to him, where are the men? See, the messengers, the malakim, are mentioned as looking like men in the scriptures. It says, where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us and let us know them. This is speaking of the fact that they wanted to rape the messengers of YaHuWaH. These men, their sexual immorality was so great that when they looked upon the messengers of YaHuWaH, when they saw them out in the city square, that they lusted inside of themselves for the men of YaHuWaH. And they came to Lot's house and they demanded the men so that they could rape the men. And this is where the word in English, sodomy, comes from. Sodomy, the sexual act that is usually labeled as homosexuality, the scriptures declare that it is one of the great sins of Sodom, according to Genesis 19. One of the great sins of Sodom was the very act, that people today are saying you should be proud of. Not only proud of your abominations, but that you should promote your abominations in the public, in front of men, women, and children, no matter their beliefs, that you should parade through the streets, that legislation should be made in certain countries, namely the United States of America, that would condone such acts and abominations, and even give these people the ability to marry. Well, we know that's not marriage. The scripture tells us what marriage is. Marriage is a very real thing that came from the Creator, one of the very first gifts that He gave to mankind, that He gave to Adam in the scriptures. Now they're infringing on our rights. But when they infringe on our rights, oh, it's okay. It's okay because you believe in the scriptures, so we're allowed to infringe on your beliefs. This is the sin. This is the sin. I don't want to go off into that tangent. We're going to go off into that tangent in a moment. But for now, I want to focus in what exactly was taking place in Sodom. It said they wanted to know them. They wanted to rape them. So Lot went out to them through the doorway and shut the door behind him and said, "Please, my brothers, do not do evil. Do not do evil." The scriptures explicitly lay it out. It's wickedness. It's evil. It's corrupt. Do not do evil. "Look, please, I have two daughters." He's so desperate. He don't know what to do. I'm not going to agree with what he does here, what he says here. But this is how desperate Lot is. He knows the seriousness of this act that they're wanting to perform and how devastating that this is, the great abomination. And he knows that this is going to surely bring down the wrath of YaHuWaH on the land. So he says, "Please let me," he says, "I have two daughters who have not known a man. Please let me bring them out to you and do to them as you wish. Only do not do this deed to these men, because they have come under the shadow of my roof." Now listen to what I said. "But they said, 'Stand back.' And they said, 'This one came in to sojourn. So, and shall he always be our judge? Now we are going to treat you worse than them.'" So now these violent sexual criminals are now threatening the life of Lot, that they are going to rape him to death. Literally, is probably what's going to happen, is what they're insinuating. So they say they're going to do worse to Lot than they were going to do to the messengers. And it says, "So they pressed hard against the man Lot and came near to break down the door. But the men reached out their hands and pulled Lot into the house with them and shut the door. Then they struck the men who were at the doorway of the house with blindness, both small and great. And they wearied themselves groping for the door." Blinding them was symbolic. Because you see, they were already blind. They were already in a state of blindness, a state where they had shut their eyes to what YaHuWaH had done. It was not much time before this that Noah got off the ark. It was not much time before this that the Tower of Babel came tumbling down and the civilizations were all dispersed. And yet they did not heed the warning. They did not heed or tremble before YaHuWaH. Instead, they had burned inside with sexual immorality. Verse 15 says, "And when the morning dawned, the Malachim, the messengers, urged Lot to hurry, saying, 'Get up, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you be consumed in the punishment of the city.' And while he loitered," listen, Lot was loitering. "And while he loitered, the men took hold of his hand and his wife's hand and the hands of his two daughters, YaHuWaH having compassion on him, and they brought him out and set him outside the city." They literally had the messengers of YaHuWaH literally had to drag the family of Lot out of the city. And it came to be, when they had brought them outside, that he said, escape for your life. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. Escape to the mountains, lest you be consumed. And most of us already know this narrative. We know what the scriptures teach, that Lot and his wife and his two daughters begin to run to a small city of refuge. And on the way, Lot's wife looked back. But did she really just look back? No. She did more than look back. She went back. She began to go back towards Sodom. When she saw what was happening, she began to run back. And because she turned around and went back, she was made into what the scriptures call a memorial of salt. Some versions say literally a pillar of salt. But that word doesn't have to be pillar. It can literally mean a memorial, which makes sense because, as I said earlier, in the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, you can still find the mineral salts of the incinerated victims. So therefore, this is a picture of Lot's wife. This is what YaHuWaH was warning us. He said, remember Lot's wife. He said that at the end of the age, they will be eating, they will be drinking, they will be marrying, and they will be giving into marriage. They will be planting, they will be building, they will be doing all these things, as if to say that nothing is about to happen, that there is no Elohim that is about to judge them. Unaware, they do all these things until the son of Adam, the Ben Adam, the son of Adam, is revealed, until YaHuWaH is revealed. And what does YaHuWaH say his revelation will be like? He says it will be compared to when Noah got on the ark and the unrighteous and the wicked were destroyed in the flood. He compares it to the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah when they were destroyed after Lot escaped. And then he says, remember Lot's wife. Don't go back. When you come out of Sodom, when you come out of Babylon, don't look back. Don't go back. That's the message. That's the warning. That when YaHuWaH comes, he's going to find that many of you were given the ability to escape the fire. But you look back, but you went back into your sin, but you're still involved in that abomination. And because of this, YaHuWaH will consume you in the fire. Ezekiel, Yehezekiel, chapter 16, verse 49 says this. See, this was the crookedness of your sister Sodom. She and her daughter had pride, fullness of bread or gluttony, and they were idle. They were idle, lazy. They wasted time. And she did not help the poor and the needy. And they were haughty and did abomination, Tohubah, before me. And I took them away when I saw it. YaHuWaH does not like pride. Pride is called an abomination. If you look in the Proverbs and the Mishlei, it's called a Tohubah. It's called a filthy matter, an abominable practice to have pride. But that was one of the great sins of Sodom. And that is one of the great sins of this generation. This is one of the great sins of the entire earth. Pride. Pride. And fullness of bread. Gluttony. Fullness of bread. I mentioned the United States of America and how the United States of America decided they could make legislation which defies the Most High. But not only does the United States of America begin to make such laws, but they are gluttons. Look around America and you will see that we have people who eat themselves to death in America. While in other places in the world, there are literally children who starve to death, grown men and women who are starving to death, while gluttons in America die because they eat too much. die because they eat too much of that pork and too much of that, all these different abominations that YaHuWaH has told them not to eat. So therefore, their arteries are clogged and they have to have bypass surgeries just to keep them alive and keep them going. And they continue to have these health problems. Why? Because they defy the Most High, just like AIDS and syphilis and all these diseases are spread through the sodomite practice, through homosexuality. And all these things happen as a curse on the land, a curse on the people, because YaHuWaH said, if you keep my commandments, then none of the sicknesses of ancient Mitzrayim, of ancient Egypt, will come upon you. In other words, if you keep my practices, you will be pure. You will be Kodesh. If you keep the practices of YaHuWaH, then you will not suffer. But when you do abomination, there is a price. There is a serious price. And gluttony is not just unique to America. Gluttony can be found all over the world. I think it is safe to say you could find a glutton in every continent, perhaps in every major city. So therefore, gluttony is something that this world will be judged for. It's not just America that's going to be judged. America will be judged, but it's not just America. This is a message and a testimony against the whole world. Not just against one country. YaHuWaH says that he's going to gather every nation and he's going to burn them with his wrath, is what the scriptures say. It's what the scriptures teach. All those who have not been redeemed, all those who have not put their trust in him and who have not given their lives and their beings to him and submitted to him in true repentance through Yahushua HaMashiach, there is a day that is coming that burns like an oven, says YaHuWaH of hosts, and it will leave to them neither root nor branch, all who practice such abominations. So pride is an abomination. Fullness of bread and idleness. Laziness is an abomination to YaHuWaH. Idleness. You have so many people today who do not want to work. They do not want to do anything. They believe that the government should give them everything. This is what the land of Sodom was like. They want their handouts from the government, but yet they don't like the government. But they want everything that they have of substance to come from the government's hand. This is what Sodomites were like, crying out for the political system of Sodom to give them some type of handout, to give them some type of shelter from the storm, to nurture them and take care of them economically, to make them to the point where they had no longer to do anything constructive but waste time and eat food and have feasts and worship idols. Everything about this way of life is an abomination to YaHuWaH. And as you can obviously see, this is a reality in the world you live in. This is a reality in this day and age, especially in the United States of America, where they have made these laws and these legislations, and they continue to create confusion, to defy what YaHuWaH has taught. Even the pagan civilizations of old, many of them had a death penalty for the act of homosexuality. It's not just the Torah. So if you want to have a problem with the scriptures, you have a problem with most major civilizations that have ever existed. It has always been considered taboo, has always been considered abomination. The scriptures teach that there is nothing new under the sun. Batteries were found in ancient Mesopotamia and ancient Babylon. Therefore, we should understand that Sodom and Gomorrah was most likely a technologically advanced civilization. We should also understand that they were very skilled in medical practices and they committed abortions. How do we know this? Because the book of Enoch tells us that in the pre-flood world, man was practicing magic and committing abortion on their children. We know that ancient civilization was able to do sex operations, to change the gender of people like we see today. There is nothing new under the sun. We know that they used drugs and they were obese and that they were seen as an advanced society. Much like the ancient Romans who loved to watch the gladiators compete in the Colosseums of old. We should also assume that Sodom and Gomorrah had their own Colosseums, their own sports, and their own major events.
that were used as a form of mind control and propaganda, nothing more than what we see in this last day.
Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 18 tells us a little bit more about sexual immorality. Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 18 verse 4 reads, "Do my right rulings and guard my laws to walk in them. I am YaHuWaH your Elohim." The next several verses tell us about the act of incest, that is sexual relations within the close family. And YaHuWaH outlines this in great detail. For instance, you know, a brother and a sister are not to have intimacy with one another. A man and his aunt are not supposed to have intercourse with each other. You know, all these types of things, all these types of things are listed and outlined. You know, a father and a daughter, or a son and a mother, these types of things are not supposed to transpire. This is all outlined. I'm not going to read it all because it's very in-depth and it's long. But I do want to go to verse 21. "And do not give any of your offering to pass through to Molech. And do not profane the name of YaHuWaH Elohim. I am YaHuWaH." Now listen to what he says after this. "And do not lie with a male as with a woman. It is abomination. And do not have intercourse with any beast to defile yourself with it. And a woman does not stand before a beast to mate with it. It is a perversion. Do not defile yourselves with all these, for by all these the nations are defiled, which I am driving out before you." YaHuWaH Elohim was driving out the inhabitants of Canaan because of their wicked abominations, namely their sexual perversions. Homosexuality, sodomy, is a perversion that is akin to incest. It is akin to bestiality. You have laws in this land that protect people against incest, against things like bestiality. But now the laws are no longer protecting men and women from this barbaric act that they call homosexuality. Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 18, verse 20 in Hebrew reads, "Ve'et zakar lo tishkab mishkabi isha to'ebahu," which literally is a prohibition against men defiling themselves with men and also women defiling themselves with women. I just want to make that point very, very clear, because I have heard the argument that this is somehow just a commandment against men who would defile themselves with men sexually, but not against women who would do the same act. But in Hebrew, it is literally a prohibition against any perversion of what takes place within the genders that YaHuWaH has laid out and the act of sex that he has designed for a man and a woman to be with one another, to know one another. This is forbidden to be done the way the scriptures have outlined it in the Hebrew, for men to lie with men or women to lie with women sexually. It is against what YaHuWaH has prescribed. Now, I don't want people to think that the only abominations that I'm going to mention in this video is this particular abomination, because there are many abominations. The scriptures tell us in Devarim chapter 7 verse 25, "The carved images of their mighty ones you are to burn with fire. Do not covet the gold or the silver that is on them, nor take it for yourselves, lest you be ensnared by it. For it is an abomination." It is toyabah. That word toyabah, that word abomination, and also the Hebrew word sheketz, which is also translated abomination in many instances. These words literally mean vile, repulsive, and putrid. So all these sexual acts that we read earlier, they are definitely putrid and vile and disgusting before YaHuWaH. But also, idol worship is also vile and repulsive and disgusting before YaHuWaH, your Elohim. "And do not bring an abomination into your house, lest you be accursed like it." Pay close attention. Pay close attention to what it says. "Do not bring an abomination into your house, lest you be accursed like it. utterly loathe it and utterly hate it, for it is accursed. YaHuWaH says, don't bring that abomination into your home. That means don't bring those idols into your home, those little statues of a Buddha or Krishna or whatever it may be, the Roman Catholic idols as well, whatever it may be, don't bring those things into your home. And it also is speaking about those who practice abominations. Don't bring them into your home. If they practice abomination, if you know for a fact that they worship idols, if you know for a fact that they practice magic, if you know for a fact that they are engaged in sexual immorality, which YaHuWaH has said is tohubah, it is vile, it is disgusting, it is putrid, do not allow them in your home. You will be accursed, just as they are. Be careful, be careful. Some people talk about they're cursed. They say they're cursed. They say they feel like they're cursed because everything they do just fails. They have all kinds of problems and they don't understand why. People who try to live by the scriptures even. There are pastors and teachers out there in Christianity and in other religions as well. And they claim to be cursed. They don't understand it. It could be because of the idols in your home. It could be because of the portraits on your walls. It could be because what your sons are doing. It could be because what your daughters are doing. It could be because of what your wife is doing. It could be because of what you are doing. Better be careful with YaHuWaH's word. Devarim, chapter 22, verse 5 is applicable today. A woman does not wear that which pertains to a man, nor does a man put on a woman's garment. For whoever does this is an abomination to YaHuWaH your Elohim. YaHuWaH is not joking around. He is not mincing his words. He's told us clearly what abomination is. He has laid out that genders are very specific. A man is to look like a man. A woman is to look like a woman. A man is to wear the things that pertain to a man. A woman is to wear the things that pertain to a woman. All these are outlined. The sexual immoralities are outlined, not only in Leviticus chapter 18, which we read from, but a double witness is mentioned in Leviticus chapter 20. The same laws just about are reiterated only two chapters later. Why did YaHuWah reiterate the same laws again, almost word for word? Why did he say twice in the scriptures that mankind is not to lay with mankind? Why does he say this twice, as a double witness against all of you? All of the world has fallen into abomination and wickedness. YaHuWah reproves you twice because every matter is established by two or three witnesses. YaHuWah goes even further here to say that a woman does not wear that that pertains to a man, and a man does not wear that that pertains to a woman. But when you look at the Sodomite culture that they call homosexuality, you will notice that when men defile themselves with one another, one of them has to play the role of the woman and is violent, disgusting, psychologically impure, and definitely, definitely, it is an act that is outright demonic. Outright demonic. The famous warlock Aleister Crowley, he even mentions in some of his writings that sodomy done on a male opens up satanic influence that will give you mystical powers and things like that in the dark realm. He was a sorcerer that practiced dark magic. All magic is dark, but I'm just saying he was in the deepest, darkest parts of the occult. You can research him in your own time. I'm not going to give his name any more time than I can because of the disgusting abominations which he practiced. But it is a fact that these things are abomination. YaHuWah has said that they are all abomination, but that is not it. Vayikra chapter 11, Leviticus chapter 11, famous passage. Christians often will even quote the passage that says in their versions, "Be holy, for I am holy," says YaHuWah. Well, we know that word holy has pagan origin. The word is kodesh. It means to be set apart, pure, and special unto YaHuWah. And he says in this chapter, "Be kodesh, for I am kodesh." And then he tells us how we should eat. Some people say Well, the Messiah died on the stake so that I could eat anything that I desire. And some people say, well, I will never be judged by the things that I eat. But if we look in our history as human beings, in Genesis, better sheep, we see that the sin that got us kicked out of the garden was eating what YaHuWaH has said, do not eat, partaking in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So while you may find yourself in a position, Christian friend, that you believe that you are superior or more kodesh, or what you would call more holy than someone else because they practice this disgusting matter of sexual immorality, which is outlined in the scriptures, but you yourself are breaking the dietary laws that YaHuWaH has laid out, understand that he says to eat the things which he has said not to eat is an abomination. So he gives us the outline in Leviticus, Vayikra chapter 11. You could read it in your free time, but I'm going to explain really quickly. Basically, it sums up that we're not to eat any four-footed creature that walks on the earth that does not have a cloven hoof and that does not chew the cud. So you have to have both signs. You have to have a cloven hoof and you have to have them chew the cud. So something like, obviously, a lamb, a goat, cows, things like that, they are all acceptable to be eaten. They are tahor, they are clean. So they can be consumed. But YaHuWaH tells us and gives us the example of a swine, a pig. A pig has a cloven hoof, but it does not chew the cud. Therefore, it is an abomination. YaHuWaH says it is abomination. It says even their carcass you abominate. You find it revolting. You find it disgusting. But here in America, lots of people eating swine flesh. But it's not just the pig. There's also rabbits, squirrels, things like that. They are not to be consumed, right? The scriptures also tell us the laws for fish or laws for the things that swim in the oceans or the ponds or wherever they may be, that they must have both fins and scales. So that makes things like squid and octopus and shrimp and all these types of things. These things are abomination. YaHuWaH says they are abomination, literally. And then we have the rule for the birds and the things that fly. And basically, there is no real rule for them. It's just a long list of animals that we are not to eat. Things like the ostrich, things like that. The vulture, different types of things, bats. And then we also have all creeping insects are tolabah, they're abomination. Except for the grasshopper, which is also called a locust. And the cricket, anything that has back legs that extend to make them hop on the earth, specifically like the grasshopper, the locust, anything that is within that bracket of insect. That is the only insect that is considered to be tahor or clean. So that's important. Now, you may be wondering, why am I mentioning all this? Because this video is about Sodom and Gomorrah, and it's about immorality and wickedness, and how can eating something be immoral or wicked? Well, as I gave you the example of the Garden of Eden, that should be a decent enough example. But what I'm really bringing this up for is because I want everyone to see that literally there's more than one type of abomination. And YaHuWaH says that these people did abominations in Sodom and Gomorrah. So we know they ate unclean foods. We know they did all these things. But the reason I'm bringing this up is because many people who practice homosexuality will go and research in the scriptures to see what it really says. And they'll notice that it's called an abomination, but they'll also notice that eating swine's flesh is an abomination. So they realize the hypocrisy in the pastor and the spiritual leader. They realize the hypocrisies that, you know, some of these people, you know, they say, well, this is, don't do the sexual act, but then they'll have little figures of their mighty ones that they pray to, you know, and things like that. So what I want to illustrate is that we have to walk the straight and narrow for everyone who's going to scrutinize our belief and look to see if we really are practicing what we teach. We have to live a life that is governed by the will of YaHuWaH. He says to guard my commands and you will live. Choose life is the word of YaHuWaH. Choose life. Do my commands and live. It's throughout the scriptures. So there are all types of abominations. Now, if we look in the Proverbs chapter 28, verse 9, you will learn that even prayer can be an abomination. It says, he who turns away his ear from hearing the Torah, even his prayer is an abomination. That word Torah is often translated law. So in the King James Version, for instance, it's going to say, whoever turns his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is an abomination. The law is referring to the first five books of the scriptures, namely what has been called Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the books of Moshe, who's been called Moses. And these books outline the entire instruction of YaHuWah's will for his people as a sovereign nation, as the nation of Israel, or Yashareel. So the Torah is really important. But every word that comes out of YaHuWah's mouth can also be considered Torah, because the word Torah means instructions. Instructions. The instructions teach that we are to live a Kodesh life. But the scriptures also say in the book of Proverbs that if you are going to willingly turn your ear away from hearing YaHuWah's Torah, that even your prayer is an abomination. And notice that when Christians want to talk about the homosexual issue, they will bring up verses from the book of Leviticus, Vayikra. And they like to cherry pick the book of Leviticus because there's, you know, things that they agree with, but things that they don't, you know. For instance, that homosexuality is an abomination. Yes, it is wicked and disgusting. But YaHuWah says in the same book that eating shellfish, eating swine, eating squid, eating these different things, these are abominations. Eating insects, unless they're locusts, these things are abominations. YaHuWah uses the same word to describe them. Therefore, if you look at this in a legal manner, that means that when you consume your pork chop, when you consume your bacon, when you consume your sausage and all this stuff that is made by the product of swine or some unclean beast, even though you don't see it this way, it is the same as the sexual acts that are mentioned in Leviticus, because the same word in Hebrew is used to describe all these things. Whether it be incest, bestiality, homosexuality, which is really, you know, I hate to even use that word, homosexuality. I really don't. I've used it a few times in this video, and I really don't. And in reality, I call people who practice this sodomites, because that's what the scriptures say, that they are sodomites. The word sodomy comes from this word. They are those who practice sodomy. Even though there are laws against sodomy in this country, they are allowed to marry each other, even though they know that's what's going on and things like that in this nation, because it's backwards. But homosexuality implies that they were born this way. They're not born this way. Children don't come into this world sexually active. That's a lie. You might come into this world and have certain inclinations that other people might not, but everybody has their own struggles. Everybody has their own sins they have to overcome. You know, and it's perversion is what it is. You have to overcome your perversions. That's what it is. I noticed that there are a lot of cowards out there today. And this is not to insult people. I'm not trying to insult people. I'm trying to build people up here. I'm trying to give you hope. I'm trying to give you something to fuel your fire, your righteous fire for YaHuWah, not to go out and do acts of violence towards people like this, but to live a life that is pleasing to YaHuWah. And also know that you also have rights. You have rights to believe what you believe. You have rights to teach from the scriptures, rights to believe what the scriptures teach. There is nothing that says that you cannot in the United States of America. And even if it did, YaHuWah's Torah is the eternal law. It is the internal instructions. No matter where you find yourself, YaHuWah is to be praised. YaHuWah is to be served. No matter what man puts into legislation, whether he says this abomination is okay, or this is okay, or even if they were to say that you can no longer call on the name of YaHuWah, or you cannot believe in his scriptures, you have to do what the word of YaHuWah says to do, no matter what man says that you should do. You have to live righteously before YaHuWah. And as I looked in these last days. I've seen that people are cowardly reacting to these abominations. Men will not say anything. There are not many righteous men in today's world anyway, but the men who are, they're keeping their mouths shut. They're being very careful about what they say. They want to be politically correct. There's nothing correct about politics. There's nothing correct about politics. Politicians at large are liars. They're thieves, adulterers. We have esteemed a culture of idleness, of pride, of fullness of bread, all these things that defy YaHuWaH. The scriptures have made it clear what an abomination is. And all these abominations were practiced by Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboam. The sexual immoralities, the confusion amongst the genders, the pride, the slothfulness, the arrogance, the gluttony, the fullness of bread, as the scriptures teach. And we see in our culture today a major parallel, a major parallel. The scriptures say that a man wears that which pertains to a man, and a woman wears that which pertains to a woman. But we see today there is this new movement where they want to say that if you identify with another gender, despite what you are physically, then you can be considered the other gender. So if you're a man who identifies as a woman, then you can call yourself a woman and have rights as a woman. They are trying to make it law, and will, by the way, and already have in certain cities in America, where they're trying to make laws that a man can use the women's restroom if he identifies with a woman. And a woman can use the man's restroom if she identifies with a man. But they have not made any laws that says if you identify with the president of the United States, that you should be the president, that you can go sit in the Oval Office. If you did that because you say, I identify as the president, then guess what's going to happen to you? You will be arrested. Why? Because there are laws to protect the president. If you were to say, well, I identify as a kindergarten teacher and I'm going to go and teach kindergarten today, they'll probably arrest you for the same thing. Why? Because you're not a kindergarten teacher, and there are laws to protect kindergarten teachers, at least for now. At least for now. But who is protecting the children? Who is protecting the women? And who is protecting the men? No one. Legislation goes against YaHuWaH's word. America has gone against YaHuWaH's word and will be judged and is being judged. The nations have gone against YaHuWaH's word and they will be judged. This confusion cannot go on. No one is protecting the women and the children. Men, you better grow strong in the word of YaHuWaH. You better learn the word of YaHuWaH. You better pray and seek Him without ceasing for your families, for your children, for your women. Women, you better pray for your families. Children, you better pray for your parents. We live in a time of lawlessness like the world has not seen. Great tribulation is about to come up to the world. The scriptures have taught this is going to happen. It's time for the family to grow strong, to pray without ceasing, to seek YaHuWaH in this lawless time. They're teaching the children in the schools. They're indoctrinating them that a child can have two dads or two moms. They can be married to one another. They're allowing these people to adopt children so that they can imprint this lawlessness onto the next generation. And they put it in the cartoons. There's the subtle messages. And they're hiding these things and trying to teach the children that it's okay to be effeminate, or to teach the children that it's okay to identify as another gender and to put on the clothes of the other gender. They call this transgender today. It's basically nothing more than cross-dressing. And people have done this for a long time. This is nothing new. But today they market it as this brand new thing. Oh, this is a new thing. A six-year-old. If a six-year-old boy picks up a Barbie doll because he's just a six-year-old boy and doesn't know any better, and he's just curious about what this Barbie doll is all about, then the parents in this liberal, lawless time that we live in can decide that my son now identifies as a little girl, and then they can start putting dresses on him and all this stuff. Children don't have the ability to understand these types of precepts unless you teach them correctly. If you put a dress on a little boy and you start to call him by a girl's name, what's he going to do? He's going to think that this is what is expected out of him from you. And to keep you happy, he's going to keep this up. And all the while, you hate your children. You people do these things, I don't care. You can call this a hate speech. You can say what you want to say. You can ban this message in America or all over the world. It doesn't really matter to me. Truth is truth. People who do these things hate their children because they are setting their children up for systematic failure. They're setting their children up to be raped. They're setting their children up to be abused physically, mentally, and spiritually. And this will not be tolerated. This will not be tolerated. YaHuWaH Elohim will not allow this. But this is not the only sin. Not just the sexual immorality and the perversions and the things that are going on. But you also have the pride factor. Everybody's proud today, proud to be whatever ethnicity you are, whatever gender you are, or whatever gender you're not, proud to be whatever type of abomination you really are. Everything's about pride. Proud to be an American, proud to be a Canadian, proud to be a citizen of the world. Well, I don't care what kind of pride you have. And what that pride is over. The scriptures teach against pride of all forms. People are so proud and violent and cruel and hateful in these last days. Then the scriptures tell us not only were they doing the sexual abominations, not only were they filled with pride, but they're filled with bread. They are gluttons. They are lazy. And as I used the illustration earlier, people in America literally eat themselves to death while people in other places of the world die from lack of food. YaHuWaH Elohim will not be mocked. Scriptures say that they were judged because of their laziness. Men and women, boys and girls, they sit on the couch and they just play the little games. They play those little games and they watch that screen and that TV, that garbage. They watch that stuff all day long. You can ask them anything about the scriptures and they'll fail to know. You can ask Americans almost anything about recent history and they will fail to know. But you ask them about their favorite football team or their favorite baseball team. Well, congratulations, men. While the world is falling apart around you, you can run down the field with a ball. That is a major feat for a human being. It is a major feat for a human being to be able to hit a ball across the field and to be able to run around some bases. That's a major thing, I guess, in this lawless day. People are so determined that they will be entertained. And if it's not sports, it's soap operas, it's movies, it's shows, it's all this. Addicted to these things when they could be reading the scriptures. They could be seeking YaHuWaH. You know, it takes time to seek YaHuWaH. YaHuWaH said, if you seek me with your whole heart, your whole soul, your whole mind, you will find me. It takes a little bit more than just a little bit of effort. It takes some time. It takes tears. It takes hours. It takes time to press in, to seek him, so that he will reveal himself to you. Because he's not going to give you everything at once. He wants a relationship with his people. But they're too busy. Too busy, you know, sitting down and let life pass them by. Life is only made of moments, folks. If you waste all of those moments, if you waste all of your time, you're going to find yourself one day on the verge of death, wondering what on earth you did with that precious gift that you called life. Let's go on. We're going to look at Matityahu chapter 10, verse 14. And whoever does not receive you nor hear your words, this is Messiah Yahushua speaking, when you leave that house or city, shake off the dust from your feet. America, you have not heard the message. You have not heard the message which I'm speaking. The message which my brothers and sisters all over the world are declaring, the name of YaHuWaH, the name of his son Yahushua, and the Torah of our Elohim, you have not heeded the message. This whole land, this whole planet is planet Sodom. and the whole earth has not received the message of YaHuWaH HaMashiach. They have not listened nor given ear, nor have they heeded his words. Therefore, we wipe the dust off of our feet as a witness against you, America, as a witness against you to the entire earth, wherever this message may be viewed. There is not a land on this planet that does not need to heed the words that are coming out of my mouth. I've mentioned America a few times because American civilization infects the entire world. Notice I said infect, not affect. There is an infestation, an infection that is growing, and it comes largely out of Western civilization. I'm not saying that Eastern civilization is pure by any means. There's a lot of backwardness, perversions, wickedness, all types of brutalities and sicknesses and things that happen all over the world. This message should be heeded everywhere. YaHuWaH is against you. All of you, the entire world, he's against you unless you heed his words and turn to his son YaHuWaH and repent of your sins. It says this, wipe off the dust from your feet. Shake off the dust from your feet. Truly I say to you, it shall be more bearable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Heed those words. Those are powerful words from YaHuWaH. Now let us go to 2 Kephah. That is 2 Peter, for those of you who may not know the Hebrew. 2 Kephah, and we're going to go to chapter 2. And we're going to read starting in verse 4. For if Elohim did not spare the messengers who sinned, but sent them to Tartaros and delivered them into chains of darkness, to be kept for judgment, and did not spare the world of old, but preserved Noach, a proclaimer of righteousness, and seven others, bringing in the flood on the world of the wicked, and having reduced to ashes the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, and condemned them to destruction, having made them an example we can still see today, an example to those who afterward would live wickedly. And rescued righteous Lot, who was oppressed with the indecent behavior of the lawless. For day after day, that righteous man dwelling among them tortured his righteous being by seeing and hearing those lawless works. Then YaHuWaH knows how to rescue the reverent ones from trial and to keep the unrighteous unto the day of judgment to be punished. And most of all, those walking after the flesh. Walking after the flesh in filthy lust and despising authority, bold, headstrong, speaking evil of esteemed ones, whereas messengers who are greater in strength and power do not bring a slanderous accusation against them before the master. And these, like natural, unreasoning beasts, having been born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheme that which they do not know, shall be destroyed in the destruction, being about to receive the wages of unrighteousness, deeming indulgence in the day of pleasure, spots and blemishes, reveling in their own deceptions while they feast with you, having eyes filled with an adulteress, and unable to cease from sin, enticing unstable beings, having a heart trained in greed, children of a curse. Having left the right way, they went astray, having followed the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. But he was rebuked for his transgression. A dumb donkey speaking with the voice of a man restrained the madness of the prophet. These are fountains without water, clouds driven by a storm, to whom the blackest darkness is kept forever. For speaking arrogant nonsense, they entice through the lust of the flesh, through indecencies, the ones who have indeed escaped from those living in delusion, promising them freedom, though themselves being slaves of corruption. For one is a slave to whatever overcomes him. For if they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of the Master and Savior YaHuWaH, Messiah, they are again entangled in them and overcome. The latter end is worse for them than the first. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it, turned from the set-apart command delivered to them. What did the scripture say? If you turn your ears from the Torah, your prayer is an abomination. For then the proverb has proved true. A dog returns to his own vomit, and a washed sow returns to rolling in the mud. The scriptures are very clear. It would have been better for you if you had not known these truths than to know what I'm saying today and to turn your back on the word of YaHuWaH. In Ezekiel chapter 14, YaHuWaH says concerning the destruction that was going to happen in that time, that if Noah, Daniel, and Job, who was called Job in Hebrew, if they were in the city, that they would only be able to deliver themselves by their righteousness. That means that they would not be able to deliver not even the city, not even their families, only themselves individually by their righteousness. What does that say about the coming time of darkness? You better be walking with YaHuWaH. You better have your priorities in order. You better have your houses in order. You better be monitoring your children and what they're involving themselves in and guiding them and giving them leadership in these days. Don't rely on a teacher in a secular school to be teaching your children and to be giving them the moral education that they deserve and that they need to thrive in this time of darkness. Do not rely upon the government to provide these things for you. Do what you need to do to be righteous. Don't let life pass you by. Don't expect others to do it for you. You have to stand up. You have to rise up. You have to be men. You have to be women. You have to be strong. You have to pray without ceasing and seek YaHuWaH in this dark time. Do it for yourselves, for your families. We are in a dark and terrible time. We live in a time of lawlessness, brothers and sisters. They will teach your little boys in the school that they could grow up to be women. They will teach your little girls that they could grow up to be men. It's time for the men to take a stand. It's time for the women to join their men and take that stand together. It's time to pray. It's time to seek YaHuWaH as a family. It's time to be strong. It's time to educate your children, because the time of the fire is coming. The time of the burning of planet Sodom is near at hand. Now let us go to Jude, Yehuda, chapter 1. And we're going to start in verse 6. It's very similar to what we read just a moment ago in Kephah. And I don't even have to read all these passages. I'm only doing it because of the power of YaHuWaH's word. And the messengers who did not keep their own principality, but left their own dwelling, he has kept in everlasting shackles under darkness for the judgment of the great day. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar way to these, having given themselves over to whoring and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, undergoing judicial punishment of everlasting fire. That's what's going to happen. That's what's coming. Everlasting fire. The scripture says in Isaiah chapter 66, Yeshayahu chapter 66, behold, YaHuWaH is coming with his chariots and with his fire, and by his sword he shall judge all flesh. Hallelujah. In the same way, these dreamers defile the flesh and reject authority and speak evil of esteemed ones. But Michael, the chief messenger, in contending with the devil, when he disputed about the body of Moshe, presumed not to be bringing him a blasphemous accusation, but said, YaHuWaH rebuke you. But these blaspheme that which they do not know, and that which they know naturally, like unreasoning beasts. In these they corrupt themselves. Woe to them, because they have gone in the way of Cain, or Cain, and given themselves to the delusion of Balaam for a reward, and perished in the rebellion of Korah. These are rocky reefs in your love feasts, feasting with you, feeding themselves without fear. Waterless clouds borne by the winds, late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots. Wild waves of the sea, foaming up for their own shame, straying stars for whom the blackness of darkness is kept forever. And Hanuk, the seventh from Adam, also prophesied of these, saying, see, YaHuWaH comes with myriads of his Kodeshim, or set apart ones, to execute judgment on all to punish all who are wicked among them concerning all their wicked works, which they have committed in a wicked way, and concerning all the harsh words which wicked sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, complainers, who walk around according to their own lusts, and their mouth speaks proudly, admiring faces of others for the sake of gain. But you, beloved ones, remember these words spoken before by the emissaries of the Master Yahushua HaMashiach, because they told you that there would be mockers in the last time who would walk according to their own wicked lust. These are the ones who cause divisions, not having the Ruach. But you, beloved ones, building yourselves up in your most Kodesh belief, praying in the Kodesh Ruach, the Ruach HaKodesh, the set apart wind and breath, keep yourselves in the love of Elohim, looking for the compassion of our Master Yahushua Messiah unto everlasting life, and show compassion towards some who are doubting, but others save with fear, snatching them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. And to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his esteem and excellent and exceeding joy, to the one wise Elohim, our Savior, be esteem and greatness and might and authority both now and forever. Amen. In Romans chapter 1 verse 18, we read, "For the wrath of Elohim is revealed from heaven against all wickedness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known of Elohim is manifest among them, for Elohim has manifested it among them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible qualities have been clearly seen, being understood from that which has been made, both his everlasting power and mightiness, for them to be without excuse. Because although they knew him, they did not esteem him as Elohim, nor gave thanks, but became vain in their reasonings, and their undiscerning heart was darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools, and changed the esteem of the incorruptible Elohim into the likeness of an image of corruptible man, and of birds, and of four-footed beasts, and reptiles. Therefore Elohim gave them up to uncleanliness in the lust of their hearts, to disrespect their bodies among themselves, who changed the truth of Elohim into the falsehood, and worshipped and served what was created rather than the Creator, who is Baruch forever. Amen. Because of this, Elohim gave them over to degrading passions. For even their women exchanged natural relations for that which is against nature. And likewise, the men also, having left natural relations with women, burning in their lust for one another, men with men committed indecency, and receiving back the reward which was due to their straying. And even as they did not think it worthwhile to possess the knowledge of Elohim, Elohim gave them over to a worthless mind, to do that which is improper, having been filled with all unrighteousness, whoring, wickedness, greed, evil, filled with envy, murder, fighting, deceit, evil habits, whisperers, slanderers, haters of Elohim, insolent, proud, boasters, devisers of evils, disobedient to parents, without discernment, covenant breakers, unloving, unforgiving, ruthless, who, though they know the righteousness of Elohim, that those who practice such deserve death, not only do they do the same, but also approve of those who do them." Corinthians chapter 6 verse 9 says, "Do you not know that the unrighteous shall not inherit the reign of Elohim? Do not be deceived. Neither those who whore, nor adulterers, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, those who abominate themselves with the same gender, nor thieves, nor greedy of gain, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor swindlers shall inherit the reign of Elohim. And such were some of you. But you were washed. But you were made Kodesh, or set apart. You were declared right in the name of the Master Yahushua and by the Ruach of Elohim. So therefore, we see here that there is a way out. But we also see all the things that YaHuWaH hates. 1 John 3 verse 4 says, everyone doing sin breaks the law, for sin is breaking the law. So that word law is Torah. So therefore, if we read, we see that the breaking of the Torah is sin. So when you break a commandment that YaHuWaH has prescribed in the scriptures in the Torah, then you are sinning. That is what sin is. What was the message of Yahushua? Go and sin no more. He constantly taught, repent, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That is my message right now. Repent, repent, because that door is closing. That time is closing. The time of the fire is at hand. The Mashiach, the Messiah, is at the door. Revelation 21 verse 6 reads, and he said to me, it is done. I am the Aleph and the Tau, the beginning and the end. To the one who thirsts, I shall give to the fountain of the water of life without payment. The one who overcomes shall inherit all this, and I shall be his Elohim, and he shall be my son. But as for the cowardly and untrustworthy and abominable and murderers and those who whore and drug sorcerers and adulterers and all that are false, their part is in the lake of fire, the lake which burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Revelation 22 verse 11. He who does wrong, let him do more wrong. He who is filthy, let him be more filthy. He who is righteous, let him be more righteous. He is Kodesh or set apart, let him be more Kodesh. And see, I am coming speedily, and my reward is with me to give to each according to his work. I am the Aleph and the Tau, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Baruch are those doing his commands, so that the authority shall be theirs unto the tree of life and to enter through the gates into the city. So we're supposed to keep the commands so we can even eat from the tree of life. But outside the city are the dogs, those who enchant with drugs, and those who whore, and the murderers, and the adulterers, and those who love to do falsehood. I, Yahushua, have sent my messenger to witness to you these matters in the assemblies. I am the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star, and the Ruach and the bride say, come. And he who hears, let him say, come. And he who thirsts, come. And he who desires it, take the water of life without paying. Now is the time to repent. That time is closing. That door is closing. We see the wickedness practiced in all the nations of the earth. We see people who claim religion, who are committing all types of abominations. We see the sodomy that has been performed, the pedophilia that is being performed by the Roman Catholic priest, that disgusting matter, disgusting abomination against those children. But nobody's protecting those children. Nobody's taking a stand for those children. We see the rapes that are being committed by Muslims all over the world. But nobody's taking a stand for righteousness in fear. Bunch of cowards. Nobody's calling out the politicians. They lit up the White House and the United States of America with the rainbow, the very symbol that YaHuWaH put in the Shemayim in the sky, so that when we see it, we remember that he destroyed the earth with the great flood, but he is giving us a covenant that we can keep his commands. And he gave this sign of the covenant to Noah. But now they take the sign and they desecrate it and they use it for their sodomite agenda. They light up the White House. Only a sodomite would do such a thing. Only one who sympathizes with this belief system because they inwardly are practicing it would do such a thing. I know I said earlier, this may not have been a politically correct message. And as I said, there is nothing correct about politics. The only truth, the only correct interpretation of life can be found in the words of YaHuWaH that he has given to us through his prophets, through his son Yahushua. This is the hope. This is the truth. We are to put our trust in Him because this planet will be consumed in the wrath of YaHuWaH. The day of Armageddon, is coming. The time of the great destruction where all nations shall gather to fight in Israel. All nations will be called to the war. YaHuWaH will feed the flesh of their kings and their leaders to the birds on that day when He utterly consumes them in His wrath. YaHuWaH will bring the fire, just as He brought the fire to Sodom and Gomorrah, and their ashen remains are a witness against all of you, against your wickedness. It is time to stop being cowards. I looked all over the earth and I listened to see who was preaching truth, who was proclaiming, who was taking a stand for righteousness, who was crying out against the wickedness of Sodom. And I heard not a voice on the earth. And I see a bunch of men who are cowardly, hiding themselves from reality, filling their mind with the television and idleness and fullness of bread and pride and lies, deceit. It's time to rise up, righteous men. Seek YaHuWaH with fasting and prayer. Seek Him. That is all you have. Women and children, that is all that you have. Seek Him with all of your heart, mind, and being. In that day you will find Him. The darkness is growing darker, but the light within you will be ever brighter through the testimony of Yahushua and the righteous truth that He has given to us. I stand with the word of YaHuWaH. I stand with the people of YaHuWaH. I stand with YaHuWaH's righteous decrees and His righteous Messiah. And there is not a person on the earth that will be able to escape from the judgments and the wrath that YaHuWaH is about to pour out, unless they do likewise, unless they stand with the word of YaHuWaH. You can hate the messenger, and that is all that I am. But your real problem, if you had a problem with anything I said today, is with YaHuWaH Elohim. It is with the Creator of the universe. He has willed that you be in this world for a reason. You have heard this message for a reason. If you have involved yourself with these wicked sexual immoralities or with any of these things, pride and fullness of bread and all these matters that YaHuWaH has called out as being abomination, you have a short window of opportunity to repent. But that door is closing. YaHuWaH be with His elect. Shalom to my brothers and sisters. Shalom.